Jeez, I was muted. Good morning, everybody. No. You're tuned to Computers Tuca now on the Nissan Communications Network. I'm Amnon, your host for the next, we're going to try for 3 hours today, along with Nick is here.
Hello.
Hello. And Mike is here. Now Mike is muted.
Not really.
But he's doing it on purpose.
Gotcha.
And Marley's here.
Oh, good Sunday morning to you.
Good Sunday morning to you. Our number, 919-518-9773. Or you can reach us at Computers2KVoice on Skype. And today's show is being brought to you by Atomos.com, makers of professional quality video recorders and converters. And the broadcast is made possible by Telestream Wirecast software. So what is happening, guys?
Stomach.
Stomach? Did I hear you say stomach?
Storm.
A storm. Yeah, stomach.
Stomach, too. I'm sick of the storm.
What is Andrew was saying that yesterday on ABC... They were actually showing videos from the coast here, which I don't know, calling it Joaquin.
Well, that's said, not surprising. It's ABC.
Whoops. That's all right. It's fine. He'll be back. He's having some computer problem. There he is.
It's refreshing. Don't worry.
It's all right. Nick, you know what? Here, that's a good time to talk about it.
What are we talking about?
Explain. You never really explained it to me, but I know you know the way.
This is gonna get you a copyright strike if there's no audio.
I don't know. Don't worry about it. I learn that the only thing that they can do is put advertising for whoever wants to do it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So area in South Carolina right now.
Nick, if you froze the video, chances are the scanner wouldn't pick it up.
I don't know.
I don't know if I can freeze it.
I mean, it's
now it goes black.
I don't think there's any, Mike, is there any?
Plus, this isn't like a TV show. It's
right.
Just
it's
live
not like a
show.
Game that has all kind of advertising it. Agreements and things like that. So I don't know. We'll see. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
But I want you. Okay. I mean, okay. We saw the storm. I want to see you. So we were talking last Monday and you were forecasting it and you were showing us what's going on, how all the models are. What?
Now, before you say this, I'm not a professional meteorologist.
I know. I understand. But I think you understand enough to explain to me something that you said you were going to explain later and we forgot. All the models were taking it into North Carolina, kind of, or into the U.S. And the European model was going way out to sea.
Yes.
And you said it, and you said it right. You can't trust one model when everything else is. When I said that our local meteorologist always said that the European was better. Now,
which I would, let me finish. Argue, but if there's 1,000 things and you choose one, you're either 100% right or 100% wrong.
Okay,
you look like an idiot when that doesn't come true.
So the track that it took is really the way that the European was saying it was going to take.
Correct.
And you were saying that it's because they have a faster computer.
Yes.
Okay, so I want to understand, and I understand your comment when I said, look, 2 + 2 = 4, whether you take a fraction of a second to calculate it or 5 minutes.
Exactly.
But are we talking about faster, and that may solve all the problem with your answer. Are we talking faster as in days faster or in a couple of hours faster?
No.
When it takes all the data in.
No, it's, you can't really equate it like that. That's not logical for this. I'm trying to figure out the best way to describe it. So, I mean, think about the weather right now. What do you have right now? You have barometric pressure. You have wind speed.
Right. Yeah. Temperature. You have.
Temperature. You have dew point. I mean, there's
yeah. a bunch of
hundreds of parameters.
Variables. So,
variables, parameters, whatever. So a weather model has to pretty much guess all that stuff for the most part. No computer could accurately get those readings from every single X and Y coordinate from across the entire country, right?
Okay, that's correct.
So a faster weather model does, in theory, which doesn't work all the time, in theory, they're rescuing somebody right now, doesn't make the guess quicker. But it can guess the parameters a little bit quicker, perhaps, and maybe right. If a weather model had to calculate every single, if it had to take real scientific data from uh-huh. every single one of those variables from all across the United States, it would take days to get a forecast. And by the time the forecast was output, it would be 4 days out of date. So there would be no use of it. See what I'm saying?
Yes. So now let me ask you this. So does the GFS, is that?
Yeah. That's the
does goal. The GFS and the European models, those, let's just take those two.
Yeah.
Do they import into their calculation the same variables, or there's not no way to know?
It depends. I mean, I don't know for sure, but.
Okay.
The GFS is controlled by NOAA,
right?
And NOAA's got the National Weather Service. So there was a lot of radio snow data, those little weather balloons going up during Joaquin. So they may have had that data, and the Euro may not have. But it's not the kind of data they're getting. It's how the computer is interpreting that data.
Okay.
I mean, think about it. Think about forecasting. Think about what these models have to do. They have to take the entire globe, entire world, and forecast the weather for every single location. And it has to be quick. I mean, that's the key. It doesn't matter if it takes 36 hours to get a forecast.
It
doesn't matter. It's got to be instant. You have to have the forecast within a typical model run is like an hour or maybe two.
So how do you have any idea how did we end up with the Europeans have a better computer than what the United States can have?
It's like one company having computers running Windows XP and one having Windows 7.
Yeah, I understand. But I mean,
they take turns updating. So like right now, the GFS is far behind. So the next GFS update, it'll be faster than the Euro. And then the Euro will update, it'll be faster than the GFS.
Okay, so do you think that if the GFS and the Euro had the same computer, is there a chance that it would have come out with the same outcome?
Is there a chance? Of course.
But it wouldn't. You don't think it would have?
No, okay. Each thing, some, for example, the GFS is really good at predicting snowfall. In my opinion, the Euro kind of lacks. It's each model interprets certain weather.
I'm talking about Joaquin.
Yeah, well, but that's what I'm telling you. Each model forecasts different weather events differently.
Okay. All right.
So some models that, for example, the GLDF is typically pretty good with tropical storms. In this case, it wasn't as good. But typically, it's really good. So you have to look at track record of a model. You have to look at the past events and you know, decide what you're going to do. But that's why those spaghetti models are really useful. So you can see, like, you can see the Euro and the GFS and all of its ensembles, which are pretty much like secondary model runs with just different calculations, different variables.
And what the weather channel or whatever the all the centers are showing us is, look, there are 10 of what?
Not the weather channel.
No. I don't know. What is the authority? The weather authority. What is this?
National Hurricane Center.
National Hurricane Center. They take the spaghetti and they say, okay, so if there are 15 of them going this way, we have to go with that.
No, not at all. The model is not a forecast. It's a forecasting tool. There's still use human input on that.
Okay.
Because here's the thing. You also have to look at the, and this is probably boring for a lot of people and they don't care, so we'll wrap it up. You have to, just because, let's say a weather model is initialized with certain parameters, right? Something simple. It says it's initialized with the temperature being 50 degrees. Well, let's say you know realistically that the temperature is 70 degrees at that time, and the model was initialized wrong, or it's using bad data. Now you have to pretty much discount whatever that model is saying. So it's a forecasting tool, and that's where a lot of people get all screwed up. They see one model running, they're like, "Oh, that's going to be the next forecast." No, it's human. It's a human forecast using computers to help. A model is not a forecast. It's impossible. It'd be stupid to take a model and say, "Oh, that's a forecast."
Interesting.
There you go.
Interesting.
Well, this whole exercise is ridiculous.
What is it?
This whole exercise trying to predict the weather. These rascals need to use the global warming computer. that thing is accurate to 100 years out.
Yeah, it's you can only give them so much crap.
I know, 100 years. This thing's predicting 100 years, and they're sitting there worrying about 24 hours. It's ridiculous. I was probably sitting right beside the same computers they're using for all this other stuff.
Yeah. That's called famous last words. Besides, nobody can use it because Al Gore has his hand on it. He turns it on.
Al Gore to use it.
Yeah.
Wouldn't be worth it when there's a big storm. They ought to be able to tell us which storms are going to hit 50 years from now.
And by the way, I think the Hurricane Center did a very good job with the storm. Even though the track was all over the place, they were following model guidance and following current conditions.
Joe Bastardi nailed it.
They did the best they could do. Who is Joe Bastardi? That don't know, Mike.
Joe Bastardi, you tell who he is. He's the head meteorological prognosticator for Weather Bell, which he used to be with AccuWeather, I think.
Yeah, Weather Bell is it's like a site I subscribe to monthly for model runs, model forecasts.
Dr. John says, except they use real data for short-term forecasts.
Of course, yes. That's why. All of the National Weather Service offices east of the Mississippi were doing 4 radio snowed updates, which are those weather balloon updates a day, to try to get as much real-time data on the trough.
Well, I'm all in favor of using real data for long-term forecasts.
Well, but real data, long-term forecasts, you have to pretty much guess the data.
So, in other words, this 100-year prediction may not be accurate.
Mike, you ready? I'm sorry. Yes, it may not be.
Man, that changes everything.
Yeah. I mean, you think about that. The Weather Service has issues predicting stuff 48 hours out, and it's not their fault. It's just lack of, I mean, there's just, everybody, people assume that, and you see a lot of people on the internet, and it really upsets me. People just assume that weather is an exact science, and it's really not.
Well, they're predicting 100 years, Nick.
No, but not even that. You know, predicting 48 hours. Think about it. You say, oh, they can't predict 48 hours out. Think about that. Yes, they can't predict. That's not set in stone. Predict.
Even your temperature gauge in your car, which could be scientific, is not exact.
Exactly.
You take three different cars, same model, same year and everything, and each one will show different. It's an indication. So you get an idea. A storm is coming. Yeah, it's coming. Whether you pay attention to how bad and all this, it seems like they always try to make it sound worse than it is because they want you to be ready.
Exactly. And that's another thing, too. You have to be... You can decide, you know, you can sit there on the North Carolina coast and say, nah, these idiots in the National Weather Service, they have no freaking clue what they're doing. They're wrong. It's not going to hit the coast. But then when it hits the coast, you're the one you're the one that looks like an idiot. So
it's better to be an idiot on the side and err on the side of.
But you don't have to be an idiot to err on the side.
Well,
of
some people would think that they're an idiot.
No, but you can just be prepared. Like you can just say, all right, you know, hey, guys, if this storm's going to come close, why doesn't everybody come stay at my house? Or I'm going to go out to the store and get, you know, a case or two of water if we don't already have that. But that's not being an idiot. I mean, what are you going to do? Not drink the water if it doesn't hit? So.
Okay.
Keep that in mind.
That's good information, Nick. Thank you. It brings it down to so everybody understands.
Yeah, this thing right now is pretty good going to hit Bermuda, it looks like.
Dr. John was saying the worst supposed to hit today. Last night, the on the news, they were saying the worst is over for us. So I don't know if he's meaning that the storm is going to, or that. This was not, what was it? It was a front. It wasn't a storm, was it?
It was a nor'easter. What typically slams the East Coast with snowfall come like February is what you guys had. But it was tropical, though. It was tropical rain. It had nothing to do with, you guys, Charleston and South Carolina would have gotten 16 inches of rain plus whatever the hurricane would have dropped. This had absolutely nothing to do with Joaquin at all.
And New York actually was saved.
Saved? I don't think they were ever.
You know. Well, I mean, you know, it wasn't. They were thinking that it's going to be another Sandy.
That was idiot media at its finest. This was nothing like Sandy at all.
Yeah.
If anything, you guys in North Carolina would have gotten hit really good because it would have been a Category 1 hurricane when it hit.
Yeah. Oh, I'm not saying that we weren't. Everybody came out better.
Yes, for sure. The Bahamas got hit very hard. We haven't seen the pictures aren't out there yet, but the Bahamas got hit.
They always do.
And you don't see any of the pictures or anything because it's such a lot of those places don't even have internet.
Yeah. All right. Let's see what else. Later on, we're going to have a guest. Armin Nomir is going to join us. Armin is a Blab, Facebook, Google Plus, expert. She knows a lot about them, and we'll get into that later. That should be an interesting discussion.
What time?
I told her she can come in whenever she feels like it, because she was going to be here at 9, but she's in Colorado, and it's 7 o'clock in the morning there, and I said, first one we talked, she said, wow, that's going to be brutal. Then last night she said, okay, I'll be there 15 minutes before the show starts. I said, remember, you don't have to if it's too early. Don't push yourself.
You don't know? I said, so you don't know?
I don't know.
Okay.
But she was excited about joining us. So Marl put a link to a story about Garth Brooks.
Yeah, I thought you'd find that interesting, Amnon.
I can't help laugh. I mean,
I know, right?
It's amazing. At least, I mean, the thing was saying that the story is, those of you that are not in the chat, and I don't know why you're not in the chat, you're just listening to us. I tell you what, Marl, I'm going to let you talk about it.
Oh, well, I mean, Garth Brooks, of course, is a very well-known country artist. If you don't know who he is, you've been in a hole for a long time. He has been kind of in hiatus for a while, but he came out last week or sometime in the last few weeks in an interview and basically admitted that he's been working on a new album. And I guess he's been recording the lyrics, or I don't know, he may have, you know, the songs on a phone. And he did not, and was probably purposeful, did not say which phone it was, but he had six months worth of work that he'd been working on this new album on the phone, and something happened to them. I think he used the words that he fried the phone. Yep. So he apparently didn't back it up. And now I guess, I'm assuming Garth's got a lot of money. He's probably got some forensic scientists working on trying to recover the data from his phone. So, and I think, don't you always, when you close your show, Amnon, you always say, you know, don't forget to update your antivirus your antivirus definitions and back up your computer. Well,
yeah,
you know, I mean,
I don't think he listens to the show though.
Oh, really? I thought he did. Oh, but, yeah, and, but you know, in his defense, I just recently started backing up all of our phones and iPads and iPods.
But Mark,
I'm sorry.
You're not keeping 6 months worth of extremely expensive work on your iPhone as the sole repository.
Exactly. I mean, I'm not making any money off this stuff. Mostly it's just pictures is what we back up off of our iPods and iPhones, because we take a lot of pictures of our daughter and we want to keep them. But I mean, what's funny though, is you would think that this guy would be surrounded with some people who were working with him who would say, hey, if you're going to do that, you might want to back up your phone a little bit. So
the part of problem I have a problem with is taking that he's been working on an album for 6 months. Come on. The Beatles, in February 1963, went into the recording studio and recorded an entire album in one day.
Well,
the last song they did was Twist and Shout. It did pretty well.
Yeah. Well, I'm not a songwriter, so I'm not going to give him any grief. But
I don't do it writing. You don't go into the studio to write songs. You write them and then go in to record them.
Right. Yeah. Well, I guess that's how he creatively produces his songs, so... But yeah, I mean, you know, it'll be interesting to see if we hear any more on this.
It's Bush's fault.
Well, they were saying that the story went on. Are you done?
Yeah.
The story went on to say that it may not all be lost. They're working on the phone to see if they can recover stuff from it. And maybe they will be able to.
And global warming may not set in, and the storm may hit and it may not hit. That's just happy face on a tragedy is for him. How can
it's
that it's probably an iPhone and it really did crash. He did something wrong. So he's an idiot, because iPhones don't fail. They just work.
There is only one way to look at it. He made a mistake. He made a mistake. Mike, I'm sorry. I couldn't say that Garth Brooks is an idiot.
I can.
No.
I've read some of the things he's written. I know he's an idiot.
I don't know.
Well, I do. I just told you.
Okay.
Let me ask you a question, Amnon.
Am I talking? He made a big mistake. He did not save his stuff. He put it on a device that could have been A, stolen, B, fall in water, C, just fall down and a car drove over. It is ridiculous for somebody that's in an off in, goes in studios and does his work. It should. It's fine to do it on the phone if you're somewhere and you get inspired and you record something. But you go and you download it and put it on a professional recording somewhere device. If it was me, it would be more than one device. But the thing is, it any way you look at it, it would be a shame if those songs are lost and all that work that he done is lost. One good thing will come out of it if it is, he will not do it again, I don't think. So.
Okay, can I say what I was going to say now?
Yeah, oh yeah. What do you mean? I thought you, okay, I'm sorry.
I don't think you're hearing us, Amnon. You're talking.
You are kind of on the low side. I hear everybody else okay, but you are
he's
a little
not on
bit
the low side. Turn your speaker up. I hear him fine.
Let me ask you this question.
Yeah.
If you store some valuable information on your phone, A, have you ever heard of anyone losing their phone?
That's
a yes or no question.
No. Of course.
Right? So that's not a possibility. Let me ask this. Have you ever heard of famous artists having their property stolen from them as souvenirs?
Yes.
Okay. That's another extremely high vulnerability point.
Sure.
Now, it's an iPhone, so you'd never expect it to crash, so you can't hold him responsible for that. But at least with the first two, you would think that you would back it up to a second location.
Right.
Furthermore, let me ask another question. I got another question. I think I smell a rat. I've never heard of a recording studio who would record a major mega artist like Garth Brooks and not keep copies of it in the studio.
Absolutely.
Never heard of that.
But I was under the impression that the whole thing, it was not involved the studio. It was done by him personally at home and in a restaurant, wherever.
Then he's an even bigger idiot.
Right. Isn't that the impression you got from the article, Earl?
Well, you know, I mean, there wasn't a lot of details in the article. I mean, I'm not an artist. I don't know if these guys just get inspired when they're out,
I am,
you know, at Taco Bell or whatever. But I mean, I think a lot of people get complacent. I mean, you know, I'm an information security professional, and I get complacent because my device works. You know, I've never had my device stolen. I keep track of it. And that's probably what happened to him. I mean, I don't know if he's an idiot. I mean, Mike's a smart guy. If he says he's an idiot, I would probably agree with him. But I think he probably just got complacent. And the next thing you know, he's lost his song. So, I mean, you know, what do you do?
If he knew that this could happen and he got complacent, then he is an idiot.
Yeah.
I would think that he didn't think about it because he's probably not into technology and he wasn't thinking that this could happen. It's not being complacent, it's not knowing. And I would hope that his manager is going to give him hell and his agent is going to give him hell and his band, whoever, his wife is going to give him hell over it because say, what do you mean you didn't know?
Right. And, you know, and it does say in the article, it says it's fairly well known that Brooks isn't the earliest technology adapter.
Yeah,
it took him until last year's release of the Man Against Machine album to embrace digital music services. So you're right. I mean, maybe he's just ignorant. He doesn't know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. But
I guess that'll learn him, right? I bet you he'll back up his phone from now on.
I know what Mike is going to say later now.
Didn't say
mind reader.
He's a Mac user.
He's an idiot.
Oh, but anyway, it's, I mean, I'm not a Garth Brooks fan and I still think it's a shame that songs would get lost. Hopefully, even if they can get it, it's still in his head. I don't know. Next.
Slow down here because we got 3 hours to cover. So
that doesn't mean that we have to. I've got a great,
don't talk.
I've got a great, caricature that Kathy handed me from the funnies. And this is on Rhymes with Orange. says the good news on buying online. It's easy and you can do it in your pajamas. Nick, are you frozen?
No.
Oh.
Hello?
You just came back, yeah. Oh. So the good news, it's easy and you can do it in your pajamas. The bad news is once the transaction is over, the ad for it follows you to every website reminding you of your frivolous purchase. And you know what I'm talking about, right? You can go to different places and they're suddenly on the side. They're, oh, yeah, that's the stuff I just bought. Oh, yeah, that's the thing I just looked at. So what's the metaphor here is what is priceless. The metaphor is it is the acid reflux of online consumption. And I thought, well, Kathy is not very, technologically, she's not technical. I don't want to say anything that is going to come back to haunt me.
She loves the show.
But she saw that and she thought enough of it to let me see the acid reflux of online consumption. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
I think you need to turn your speaker up. Are you hearing us when we're talking?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
I can hear you now.
Okay. You seem to be having some issue with when you're talking.
Ducking?
No, it's not ducking. It's just it's like you're not hearing us. So maybe it is. I don't know how it could be ducking unless you're mixed or something.
The only one that I can't hear well is Mike. But it's Mike, talk.
You're muted.
No, I'm not. 1, 2, 1.
Yeah,
two,
now,
one,
now, oh, yeah, now you're into the yellows. You were hardly pushing it like 4 or 5 greens.
I haven't changed a thing.
Okay, well, it's fine now.
Okay.
Maybe it was Merle doing it.
Yeah, it was probably Merle. So, Amnon, I didn't ask you at the beginning of the show. How was your week? Got any stories?
How was your week? Any stories?
Yes.
What stories? Give us.
No, I'm asking you. How was your week?
Oh, no, the week.
No computer stories? You got nothing to talk, nothing you did this week?
No, not really. The only two things that stick in my mind from this week is a customer brought her daughter's computer. She called and she said the computer was getting slow and putting up all kind of ads. God. And I asked her what antivirus she had. And she just installed Norton. I said, ouch. We'll go ahead and try and reinstall it. That did not help much. So she took it off. She brought the computer over. It was weird. Would take forever to go from one site to the next. It just didn't want to do it. I changed DNS. I cleaned it up. I installed Avast. No, I installed Avast first. That's right. I uninstalled Avast, did the same thing. And it just wouldn't want to work. And this is her daughter is in college. She needed the computer. We couldn't see any ads, but after I ran CCleaner, even before looking to see what it'll do, I figured that's what cleaned it up. But it was.
Did you have it connected to the Wi-Fi at your house?
No. Yes. Yes. Oh, okay. Yes, because it does not, the computer does not have an Ethernet port. I don't like doing this.
Yeah, so, I was gonna say.
It started working better with Firefox. It was and it went back to being slow on Chrome. So she wanted the computer and she needed it and all that. So I said, yeah, I'll tell you what, take it like that, use it, do your papers and everything. And if it's still working bad, bring it to me when you don't need it. She said, I'll bring it back Saturday because I don't need it until Monday. I said, okay. And she didn't. So I'm assuming things are working okay.
Or maybe she hates you.
Maybe.
Possibility.
Another one.
Oh, hold on quick. What was the brand of this laptop? Was it one of those
HP laptops? What was it? Shoot. I don't remember.
Okay.
Acer? Curious. It was an i5. And the thing is, it was an i5. I said, gosh, that thing should be fast. I reinstalled Avast and it was working, but not with Chrome. I did not want to reinstall Chrome because I said, here is Firefox. At this point, just use it. So you, okay. I imported all her settings from Chrome to Firefox and everything was fine. And she had no problem with that. I then had another customer bring their machine because it was very slow. And I mean, it was very slow. They brought it over. I'm looking and it had Avast on it. It was XP. It's an old Atom processor.
Ooh.
With 1 gig of RAM. It was very slow. So I uninstalled Avast. And it was still slow. I cleaned it up. I went and to see. It will not connect to the internet, period. It will connect to one page, like to the home page, and you can reload it, and it's fine. But then you try to go somewhere else. Nope, will not go. I ran the XP fix. There is a fix for XP that will fix the TCP stack. It failed. I rebooted, ran it again. It went through. It didn't do the trick. I gave it a static IP. Didn't do the trick. At this point, Avast was on it again because I didn't want to run XP without. I went into Avast, and Avast has an option to scan the files to protect the file system, at the web, and the mail. I did away with the file system shield because I said, okay, if it's stopping viruses coming in through the web and from email, there's no reason really to have. Let's see. Suddenly everything was flying. So if you have an older computer and you're using Avast, you can do it. Now, I don't know. You may be able to do that, too, with Norton, if that's what you're using, because it came on it. I know that with Norton and with any antivirus, if it's been on for a long time, you and the computer is getting slow. If you are sure that you ran CCleaner and everything is clean, there's nothing there, and all, then you delete all your cookies, it's still slow. Just try to uninstall and reinstall your antivirus. When you're uninstalling the antivirus, make sure that you are uninstalling everything. It'll say, do you want to remove the quarantine and you want to remove user data? You want to remove everything. With Norton, you will probably also... Not just for Norton and McAfee are the two that I know of. You may have to go to their sites and get an uninstall or a cleaner that after you do the uninstall, you run it and it actually cleans all the leftovers. And then reinstall, chances are it will be back to normal. But that brought up something about Windows 8. The girl with the laptop, it was Windows 8. And Defender was there. And the fender is Windows protection for virus and malware. I installed Avast and did away with Defender, and things were working. I didn't work on enough Windows 8 machines in that capacity to do stuff like this. I would think that it's okay. If anybody has any information why you shouldn't do away with Defender,
and I do.
Okay.
Security, it's security essentials. That's what it is.
Right. I mean, well, Defender was actually the predecessor of you're right, it is
different. It's security essentials, yeah. Pre-built in. That's more than enough for
okay me. so why so there is really no reason not to do away with it and install
there's no reason to install anything else. I mean, why would you run Avast?
Well,
what's Defender not
the thing security? Is security yeah. Essentials, first of all, Defender is known to grab the CPU and slow a machine down to a crawl.
And Avast isn't?
Avast isn't. I'm using Avast on my machines. Avast is working flawlessly. But I remember when I was using Security Essentials, if the computer slows down, you do Control-Alt-Delete, you go to Task Manager, and you see the MSMP, whatever the process of Defender, is just using 70, 80, 90% CPU, and nothing is going on.
Yeah, I mean,
on this machine here, the Wirecast machine.
Personally, I've never experienced that. I just if Windows has a good tool built in, I don't know why I would uninstall
well,
it.
Well, that's what I was wondering.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, would you uninstall the default media player to install something else? No, you're just going to use the default media player. Now, you know, if you can't use a computer without getting a virus, then yeah, maybe you need a Avast. But for the vast majority of people, I think Security Essentials does fine. I mean, I download some stuff on the internet. It could be borderline not safe, and Security Essentials pops up or Defender pops up. So no, I don't have a problem with it at all.
Well, some of the reports...
I mean, I don't know what the reports are. I've never...
Yeah,
I mean,
but I'm just saying...
Notice it, but
I'm just saying that some of the reports where they compared antivirus, anti-malware, put Security Essentials down in the quality of interfering with viruses and detecting and all that. It wasn't one of the yeah, best.
Yeah. Of course. I mean, I don't get viruses on my computer, so maybe I just don't have the experience. But for the,
yeah. On this computer,
I take this offensively, but for the competent computer user that isn't getting viruses every week,
right?
You Avast, you don't Should need be. Norton, you don't need AVG. You just need to use your head and use Defender. Yeah, I'm not going to go and uninstall Defender because I don't need Defender. I mean, it's a Windows utility. It works in the background. It's fine.
Yeah, well, they all work in the background.
Something will pop up. Chrome, even by default, if you download some executable that Chrome knows is malicious,
yep,
it comes up.
Yeah,
it says, "Hey, you know, would you like?" And it doesn't even let you download it. It just it discards it automatically, and you have to go in and fish it out. I don't know how people still get viruses. It blows my mind. I can't try to get a virus, and I don't know how people do it actively or passively, whatever it is.
I see it coming up a couple of times a day, but I get oodles and oodles of emails. And being in the business, you can't just say, oh, I'm not going to read this even. So
well,
you go and look.
Yeah, an email, you don't get a virus from opening it for the most most likely. Now, is it possible? Yes, you have to run some something.
Yeah. So on this machine here, I have Security Essential, but it's turned off. It does the weekly or whatever scans at night, but the real protection, the real time protection, is off because I don't do anything. I don't go on the web to look around. I don't do email on it. It's done. The machine is up here for what we're doing, you know, doing shows. So it's not open. But I remember that there was the reason I turned it off is because it was slowing down the machine. Big time sometimes.
Yeah. So I mean, Alan is saying that he prefers VLC to media players, as do I, but I'm not going to go and uninstall the default media player.
No, you can leave it. But the problem is, the problem, though, you can't compare that because you cannot have Defender. I mean, you cannot have two antivirus programs running on a machine because many times they'll screw up. I mean, you can have 10 media players.
But Charles just said if you want if Defender automatically gets disabled when you install something else.
Oh, that's good. On 8, it's not.
I just don't know how necessary it is. And I know we had this antivirus talk the other week ago, but...
Well, I mean, look, with Windows 8...
I just don't feel it's necessary for me to have to...
Okay, so explain to me this. And I know the answer. I mean, with Windows 8, had Security Essentials built in?
Yes, as Defender.
Defender. Every machine, HP, Acer, whatever... came with the McAfee on it, and it was hell getting rid of it and reactivating Defender. It's like they won't let you.
Yeah, that's every computer you buy from the store.
Well, if
that's every computer, go to a big box and buy any computer. It's going to come with Norton, or it's going to come with McAfee. Yeah. I'll bet my life on it. Every single computer.
I remember in the early days, I mean, they had a way to prevent you from installing, from using just Defender if there was already a third party antivirus. I mean, you had to go and read all the instructions and go into registry in order to get Defender to come back on and remove another one. That's when I believed in Security Essentials 100%. Things change since, but it's fine. It's you just adjust to what's going on.
Yeah, I'm not.
No, Gene, there's no reason for you to uninstall it. It works. No,
I agree, I think it works. I think it works pretty well for a free pre-installed virus software or antivirus software. I'm very happy with it.
And Gene, if you are just a normal user that doesn't go to suspicious websites and doesn't go all day long surfing just to find something, then Security Essentials is perfect.
I just don't understand how people are still getting viruses.
No.
It boggles my mind.
But it happens.
Don't know how, but I guess it does.
Yeah. 919-518-9773, Computers 2K Voice on Skype. So what happened tomorrow? Oh, he had to go. Did he say something?
Yeah, he said he left to go to church. Like,
okay.
Minutes ago.
It's not that he... I mean, I'm not watching the chat.
You're not watching the chat?
No, I'm not watching the chat.
Why?
Listen to Brian Monroe. Get a Mac. So, Patreon was hacked this week, last week. And anybody that went in there and donated money or registered, your information was accessed. According to Patreon, everything is encrypted, so even though data was accessed, it was not compromised. But they are still recommending you go in and change your passwords. Your password. Patreon is a site that allows you to go and donate money to...
It's not really donating.
What is it?
Well, you're paying for content. You're not just giving. It's not PayPal. You're not donating. You're paying for a service. Normally content, video content or audio content. It's not. I wouldn't call it donating.
So if we like, had a
look at Andrew's What the Tech campaign, are you donating to What the Tech? I mean, technically yes, but you're it's not just a blind donation. You're getting an extra show a week and other content.
Okay.
Donation. I don't know if donation is the right word for it.
All right. Well, that's what it is. It's something that you are paying money for.
Yeah,
services.
You're paying money in return to for some normally audio or video content.
Yeah.
To support, you're supporting the content creator. There you go.
Right. And you guys, you guys can support us too. And we do have a donate. I mean, for us, it's a donation.
Yeah, there you go. That's a donation.
On the left there in the menu, you can see PayPal donate. Now, if you're using Chrome for Android and you have the incognito mode and you use it, there's a bug that was found. It really isn't as locked down as it designed to be. Some sites you visit while using the privacy feature are still saved and can be retrieved simply by opening the browser's settings. Google Chrome for Android has had incognito mode since February 2012. And the way that Google official description of the feature, it says if you don't want Google Chrome to save a record of what you visit and download, you can browse the web in incognito mode. And that obviously is not working the way that they are saying, because if it saves, then people can find. I've never used it. I don't know that I would know how to use it. But I'm wondering, give me an example of why you would want to use go on the web incognito.
Oh, I use it all the time. So
for what? That's what I'm saying. Give me an example. Okay. Where?
I
know you don't go to porn sites.
Well, that's okay. The Google is a total bear when you want to use more than one Google account. So I browse incognito to check my school email. So I don't have to log out of my other Gmail. I do it with Twitter because I'm always logged in on my main Twitter in Chrome. So I go incognito to check the Crummy Show's Twitter or the Infections Twitter all the time. I always have an incognito window open with Twitter or YouTube or something like that for another show. For example, Twitter, because it doesn't let you do more than one account. That's why I use it, because Google's awful with account management, in my opinion. I don't like it.
Yeah, so I guess there is a good reason.
It's like a cache-free version. So there's nothing saved. So you can log into a Twitter account. Then when you close that incognito window, it doesn't save any of that. So then you can, when you want to go back into another Twitter account, you just Control-Shift-N, and then you're logged into another one.
And you use it on your phone?
No, not on my phone, no.
Your tablet?
No, again, I don't have Android.
Well, they're talking about incognito for Android.
Okay, well, I don't have Android, so.
Okay.
But you asked if I use incognito, so.
What did you do with your high-priced Android phone that you had?
Oh, it's in my car. I use it for music. It's nice to have it back.
What model is it?
It's a Galaxy, Samsung Note 2. It's old now. There's like three revisions old.
Is it LGE?
LTE? I have no clue. LTE. I don't have a SIM
card. What am I saying?
Huh? I don't have a SIM card in it. I'm not sure. I think it is, though.
You want to sell it?
Probably not, but why?
Oh, I don't know. My daughter-in-law needs a phone. Hers is cramping out on her.
I don't think she'd want this one. This thing is wicked old.
Yeah. I'm going to have her take it over to Triangle Cellular Repair.
Yeah, there you go. You like those guys?
I do, and I actually ran into them at a home show, and they were very helpful. They put a new screen protector on my screen and everything, and he says normally $14.95, but you say good things about us, it's free. We're having chats about computers in chat, and we're talking about the various anti-malware utilities and things. Malwarebytes, of course, being the old faithful. It's not perfect, does a great job, price is right. Anybody can and should run it, doesn't hurt anything. And it's going to find stuff that's really not dangerous to your computer, but it has no reason for being there. so you can take it out. But there's another one too, and Gene says he likes to run Hitman Pro. Well, Hitman Pro is a pretty aggressive program. It does a great job. It has a 30-day trial. I guess you bought it, Gene, but it's a good program, and I would definitely.
Mike, you're on the low side again, by the way.
Well, I haven't changed anything. Maybe I'll check it. But I'll speak up for now. Whenever you start, I'll set it in a minute.
Okay.
How's this?
Well,
is this okay?
This is, well, this, as far as the meter, it's perfect like this, but you don't sound good.
Okay. Well, I haven't changed anything, so
I don't know.
I'm gonna finish my comment.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry. I didn't mean. Go ahead.
Can't talk but one at a time. I will disconnect and reconnect in a moment. In fact, I'll go ahead and do it now.
Oh, Amna, I have a kind of a pet peeve.
Okay, hold it.
When you're let Mike,
write it down. Remember it. Let's let Mike finish what he was going to say.
Any better now?
No.
Check 1, 2.
Okay, like showing, that, it's
you're
okay.
Hitting three bars. You're fine.
Yeah, I mean, it's showing 3 bars in the hangout.
What's the level on your mixer if it's low?
The mixer is perfect. I mean, nothing's changed.
Oh, Amnon. On Amnon's end.
Okay.
Something must have got bumped because I hear you.
Well, I don't know, because before when I was talking, I was only hitting 2 bars, and now I'm hitting 3 bars, so it may have reset something.
Well, just like what you were just talking was fine, but the minute you go a couple of inches away on the other, on the reruns machine that is sending it to the other two, I don't see any lights. I know it's getting out. The sound is getting out, even though it's not showing on the meter, but I'm just giving you something you can work with. It's not moving anything.
Well, that would have to be on your end, because you're hitting 2 bars in the hangout and I'm hitting 3. Count to 3, Nick.
1, 2, 3.
Nick and I are exactly the same level in the hangout.
Well, right now when you were talking, you were only lighting 2 green lights on the meter, and Nick was bringing up almost to the orange.
No, that's impossible. We're the same.
It is. I mean, do you want me to put a camera and show you?
Well,
I'm serious.
Well, I know, but we're the same level in the hangout.
I know. I have no idea why.
Minor LA is saying that that Mike is still really low compared to you.
Compared to me?
Look at the chat.
Well, yeah, no, I mean, I'm trying to keep it right at the lower end of the orange.
Okay, how's this?
Much better, Mike. Perfect.
Okay, good. Is this okay?
Yeah, well, I mean, level it's okay, but the audio, no. Okay, well, anyway.
Can you hear me now?
Smart ass.
Okay. So I'm trying to be like a blabber.
That's a great looking mic.
All right, how you like it?
Good.
$1,000 microphone.
Okay. Can you tap
you're on the right mic? Wait a minute, you can see it. All right.
But I have no idea why it's doing that. I mean, everything is. Nick sounds great, and he moves the meter. Yep.
Okay, am I back on the right mic?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see here. Where were we? Am I still low?
Well, now, when you said, let's see, it was low. Before, when you said, all right, it was orange. When you said, let's see, but I think it's because you turned away.
I didn't turn away.
Amnon, if it's low, just turn it up on your end. There's nothing Mike can do. I'm positive. I hear him fine, and he's hitting 3 bars.
Okay.
Well,
all right.
And I suspect there's something. Now I'm hitting 4 just then. I suspect there's something strange going on with the hangout.
Yeah, but I hear you fine. I mean, I've got you on my mixer. You're hitting yellow.
Keep
I
going.
I understand, but I believe if Amnon restarted, which he should not do, but I believe if Amnon restarted, there's at least a slight chance that it would make some difference.
So what were you saying, Mike?
I have no idea.
Yeah, keep going.
Something out of chat. You were
talking about the antivirus and
well, Pro. Gene is saying that he bought a license to Hitman Pro. It's a very good program. It does a really good job. It's definitely a quality software. I've never purchased a license to it. It never seemed to me like it was worth the money, because normally what happens is when I get a computer in here that has a really tough virus or some malware or something on it, and Hitman Pro is one of the ones that I run on it. The last one I had, I've talked about several times, the last one I had, was really bizarre because I ran Malware Bytes on it. I ran Microsoft Security Essentials, House Call Online Antivirus Scan. I ran Hitman Pro. I ran ADW Cleaner. All of these tools I ran, and it was showing no problem. And I was convinced there wasn't a problem. But this computer, once you booted, it would slow down to a crawl. It would literally take 3 or 4 minutes to open a browser. And having said that, I was about ready to give up on it. And somebody somewhere suggested that I run Microsoft Safety Scanner, which I've never heard of. Never heard of it. And I ran it, and it found a really ugly, nasty, probable rootkit. Eliminated it, rebooted the computer. It's been working fine for several months. Microsoft Safety Scanner, mscert.exe. Don't know what it does. Don't know all the details, but unfortunately, you have to do what's necessary. And Brian, you're wrong. He said it's totally a waste of time to reformat and reinstall. The reason you're wrong is because a rootkit can survive a reinstall. So there you go. Yeah. And somebody, Gene, or who was it, Gene, said that the fact that you tech guys use more than one tool to clean up means that no one of them does everything all the time. And that's a fact.
That is true. If you used one tool, I mean, yeah, Mike, I mean, I've installed like 3 different anti-malware tools, and you know, only one of them gets it. So 1 out of 4 has that one flagged as malware.
And to be fair about that, that assessment, it's usually because, I'm going to put on headphones or turn your speaker up. If I had anything to eat, it probably wouldn't be happening. All right, I'm listening. Test, 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 test. It sounds normal to me here.
Yeah, I mean, you sound fine now when you're at this position.
I'm always at this position.
Well, okay. That's fine.
So what was the comment?
There you go.
There I go what?
I said, there you go.
There you go.
Then
maybe Amnon needs to turn his down the going to the stream. Well, we'll worry about it later. He was screwing around with the board yesterday. He probably got something screwed up.
No, it's I mean, I lowered it some, and I'm just getting up to the orange. So yeah, I am at time. I mean, I'm pushing it's the same all the time, but Mike at times gets to that level. Other times he's half of this. But it's getting to the stream, because I was listening on another machine to see if I hear you when you talk, and it's
okay. And what you miss sometimes, Amnon, is that your feed to the stream and your feed to the Hangout are different. They're not even related, except by the slider. When you put your slider at the normal level, you get it set for the stream, then you adjust the mix minus feed or the aux send level to get back to the Hangout. Which aux send are you using for the Hangout? Number 2?
Yeah.
Where is aux send number 2 set on your mic channel?
12. Oh, on my mic? 12.
Yep.
All of them are 12, yeah.
Well, some of them were at 9.
The ones that are not being used.
All right. Then try, just as a matter of curiosity, go over to the aux send master control on the far right side and crank it up tiny bit.
I'm distant.
In more ways than one.
I know. That's what I was going to say. So not the first time.
Yeah. Her hearing's going. She's
okay. It's at 11 o'clock now.
Oh my.
Yeah. Okay. See, that's perfect.
Yeah. There you go. You're nice and loud now.
And all the aux sends were at 9 o'clock. Should I?
No, I wouldn't change anything now. Right now we're good.
Okay. Yeah, I think you and Mike are now the exact same level in the hangout.
All right. Good.
Am I distant?
Yep.
I don't know. Nick sounds like he's right next door to me.
I'm sorry.
Well, the hangout audio is horrible anyway, and the ducking has gotten worse. It's horrible.
Yeah, it is pretty bad.
Okay. Did we finish all that? The Hitman Pro is good stuff, but the one I was going to suggest to everyone is this program from bleepingcomputer.com called ADW Cleaner. It's a free utility. I usually run it about every, I don't know, 3 or 4 months. It'll usually find some cookies and things that shouldn't be there, never anything. But just keep in mind when you run it that if it finds anything and you hit clean, it's going to automatically reboot your computer when it's done. Make sure nothing is open on your computer when you run it. If you have a document open and haven't saved it, it's going to close the word processor and possibly lose that document.
You should not be running it when other programs are open anyway.
I agree, but people get careless and just get curious. But I'm warning you, it's going to reboot your computer. It has to. And I will tell you, it has, if you say, oh, my computer's running a little slowly, then I would suggest that you try ADW Cleaner or Malwarebytes first and then the other one second. The one problem with the ADW Cleaner is that it does remove things like this coupon printer crap that are legitimate, but have a lot of crap on them.
Oh, I love my coupon
program. I know you do.
In my blog, it's one of my must-have Windows 10 programs.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. You guys don't have coupon apps?
Not on my computers.
Now, if you download programs, then you're downloading zips, and in many cases... I'm hearing myself coming up from the back.
Yeah, something strange going here. I don't hear it.
Check.
I'm gonna exit. It's me.
I would refresh you.
Whoops. Oh.
And we're back.
You did it at the same time. It looked real bad.
Oh, yeah, no, we both refreshing.
No, it's...
Okay.
All right.
Back in the groove, right?
Back in the groove.
Back. Yeah, I don't hear myself anymore. So if you download and you...
Must be having some problems.
EMP.
And you're using a program to unzip, there's a good chance you're using WinRAR. And there's a critical vulnerability that has been found in the latest version of WinRAR. The popular file archiver and compressor utility for Windows and can be exploited by remote attackers to compromise a machine on which the software is installed. The issue is located in the text and icon function of the text to display in SFX window. Vulnerability Lab explains in a post on the full disclosure mailing list, and they're saying remote attackers are able to generate uncompressed archives with malicious payloads to execute system-specific codes for compromise. Now, in reality, the chances that somebody is going to get into your machine if you have a router and you are using NAT, look, I mean, are one in a zillion. But it's good to know. Huh?
I said I like those odds.
But yeah, unless, I mean, if you're on a network somewhere that is on with static IPs and machines, every machine has an IP address and you don't have a good firewall, that then something could happen. But if you're home, you are using NAT, I'm sure, and it's not that bad. But you should be aware of this. Which brings me to another story that happened this week. Mike, this is something that I never thought about. Where's Mike? I want Mike to be here. I'll wait until he gets back. That's fine. That's okay. No, that's okay.
I'm sorry. That's so funny.
Nick, yesterday we actually figured out how to do a blab with Wirecast and all that, and that it will not echo.
Okay, yeah.
But we still don't know how to be able to bring blab into the show without echo. But it was good. Mike and I worked on it yesterday, and it was weird because I started the blab to say, so you want to broadcast, it doesn't have to be complicated. And as I started, people started saying that there's an echo.
Jesus.
And we actually, it was good because it was a good lesson for everybody. We had some technical people to tune in and say that they're enjoying it, because Mike went through what is mix minus and explaining, and I was doing it here, and I had a camera that I was pointing, and so we saw it. It was a good session. I wish I recorded it. But Mike, I was saying that this week something else happened that you should be aware of too, and everybody else for that matter. Uzi called and said that he had to go and download. You are hearing me, right, Mike?
Yeah.
Okay. Download the.
Anyone who doesn't know, Uzi is your brother.
Yeah, Uzi is my brother. And he downloaded a program for a camera that he just got, a surveillance camera. And something got on his machine. So he said, what do I do? So I walked him through CCleaner and Avast that he had on his machine and all that. And cleaned up when we went to internet options, connections, LAN settings. There was a proxy, so I had him uncheck that. And every time he would start any of his browsers, it will go back to that page that was bad. We went and we changed the home page. Tell it to go to a blank tab. And it would just not do it. I got busy. I had a show and I got busy. I said, I'll call you later. He called later. I said, I found what the problem was. So what was it? The icon for Firefox, for Chrome, and for IE. And that's on Windows 7. The icon, the shortcut, actually had data added to it that tells it to go to a certain website. So it was, no matter what you did, unless you removed the shortcut, It was messing you up.
That's interesting. That's very smart.
And all three of them. So apparently every time because he tried to do it before he called me. So while it was still in memory, he tried different browsers, and every time you start the browser, it appended something to the command line in the shortcut. And then unless you remove it, there was nothing you could do, or unless you edited it and removed that extra text. So that's something good to remember when you go and you clean your browser after something happens and you change your homepage, but it's still going to that page that you don't want it to go to, look in the shortcut and see if there is a piece of data in there that takes you there. It was very simple. I mean, there was nothing in memory. I mean, everything was removed, but it would still go to that page.
Huh.
So yeah, just keep that in mind.
Now you know.
Yep. And right now I'm on ConnectCast and it froze. Oh, that's my
machine. Yeah, all of my streams are freezing. I don't know what the issue is.
Interesting. So, I wonder if something is happening. Oh, wait a second. Something is going on with Time Warner. It's a yellow light on the stream.
It'll catch back up.
It's not red. No, let me just take a look at the modem.
Well, it's obviously working, or we wouldn't be hearing.
I wanted to see over there if there was something.
No, Nissan Communications just went off. Nissan Communications just went offline on ConnectCast.
It says offline.
Yep.
Yep. Stream up is probably working okay.
Okay.
Because it's on UVerse.
Maybe you're getting the upgrade, Amnon.
Very interesting.
Can you guys in the chat still hear us?
Oh, it will not. It will not. That's right. It will. Keep it going.
Okay.
Well, nobody's hearing
it. Let me do some. Keep
it on going. The recording, Mike. How are you, Mike?
Hi, Nick. How are you?
I'm pretty well.
How's the family?
It's good.
How's
good.
The cat?
Cat's good.
Good. All right.
Mike, I got a PlayStation this week. PlayStation 2. Man.
We're back.
How does that make you feel?
I'm excited.
This guy was practically giving it away.
I know. I may have some out in our storage room if I can find them. We may have thrown them out.
PS2 games?
I don't know what he has. He spoiled rotten. He got everything he wanted.
Mm.
Not really, but seemed like it at the time. Charles, I got a free Google Fiber t-shirt as well, and unfortunately, I ordered the wrong size.
I didn't.
What size did you order?
I ordered a large.
Are you not a large?
No. I sort of am, but when I wear a t-shirt, this is TMI, but when I wear a t-shirt under a shirt, I wear a large because I don't like it baggy on me.
Uh-huh.
But if I wear a t-shirt out, I don't like it tight on me, so I wear an extra large. Like the shirt like you're wearing, I would wear an extra large.
Yeah, no, this is a large.
So I got confused. But guess what?
I'll take it.
I already gave it to my daughter. In fact, this is actually a good point. She might give it to you because she saw it and wanted it. So I gave it to her, my daughter who's in law school. She went out wearing it, and she said people wouldn't stop coming up to her and asking her about it.
Now wear it here, and they'll be like, wrong state, buddy.
So, Charles, have you worn it out yet? And if so, has anyone come up to you and asked you about it? The reason, again, I ask is I was at the 2 weeks ago, I was at the home show that was downtown Raleigh, and a really old guy like me was wearing one. And I went over to him and started asking him questions. And he kind of was surprised I came up to him. My wife thought so, but he was very conversant about it and was also anxiously awaiting it to be installed. And he also said that a lot of people came up to him to ask him about it. These shirts actually have dots that outline the state of North Carolina on them. So they would be useless to Nick.
Yeah, but that's a cool shirt.
Well, there anyway, I found, I was going through, I did some cleanup on digital cleanup this week. I was going back through some emails. I found the one that said, if you want a t-shirt, let us know and we'll send you one. I said, well, it's worth a shot. I hit reply on the email to Google. Now we're talking to Google, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
the
this
ones
is
that don't respond to emails,
not Time Warner, not AT&T. This is Google, big giant. All right. I replied to the email. I said, well, an unfortunate thing happened and I'm sick over it. I ordered the wrong size and went and told them what all happened. I said, is there any chance of getting a replacement? And within 2 hours, she wrote back and said, what is your shipping address?
Oh, now you have two.
Not yet, but she said it'd be 8 weeks. But she said, no, tell us no. We'd be glad to have it. Thank you for your interest. Yeah, we're working hard to build in your area, all the same stuff. So, and so I replied, I said, you guys sure do know how to build customer loyalty, don't you? Yeah. Oh, thank you. We're working hard. We'll see. They actually, you know, what was strange is I was actually on the, what was that thing? Google Helpouts. I was actually on the startup for that.
What a great idea. What a great service that was, right?
They discontinued it.
I know. It was great. Somebody will come. Mike, that's a business idea. You and I should work on something.
Several like people have done it. And in fact, whenever they had announced their shutdown, I got spammed by at least three websites that were taking it over. You can finally get paid for your advice. Sign up with us here. I just killed them.
Yeah. That's unfortunate.
I mean the money. I don't want to make money off people helping because I don't want to be obligated to it. And I don't want my answer to be relied upon. But anyway, not really, but be that as it may, they sent out hoodies and I did the same dumb thing again. I ordered a large hoodie instead of an extra large.
Oh my God.
And I contacted them and darn if they didn't send me an extra large.
So now you've got two shirts and two hoodies from Google Fiber.
I have one shirt and two hoodies.
I don't even have Verizon Fios yet.
Well.
Which, by the way, I'm not going to be getting.
Why?
They don't have the weather channel on their lineup. And you can't stream it online.
By the way, everything is back to normal.
Okay. That's a very big deal for me.
So Fios, why would Fios not have, but that probably by the time they run the fiber, they'll probably have it on there.
No, it's been gone since April.
That's a surprise.
Yeah. Like normally these things are like, I don't know, a week, 2 weeks. And it's like, you know, they just go back and forth and they come on some agreement. No, they've been down since April, March or April.
That's a surprise.
Yeah. Which is a big deal for me. Honestly, a reason I wouldn't switch.
Yeah. Well, you can switch the internet without switching the TV.
Yeah, that's another thing to think of. A lot of people probably think, oh, that's so stupid. But for me,
Well, my wife watches hockey. How stupid can you get?
That's mean.
She's here, Mike. She's hearing you.
That's okay. Actually, she's not listening right now.
That's what you think. Anyway. Ars Technica is reporting that an East Texas judge has thrown out 168 patent cases in one fell swoop. The judge order puts the most litigious patent troll of 2014, Edeca LLC, out of business. The ruling comes from a surprising source, U.S. District Court Rodney Gilstrap, the East Texas judge who has been criticized for making life extra difficult for patent defendants. Gilstrap, who hears more patent cases than any other U.S. judge, will eliminate about 10% of his entire patent docket by wiping out the DECA cases. Mike, did you ever hear about that DECA whatever?
How do you spell it? I've never heard of it.
It's E, lower E, capital D, E, K, K, A. Edeka. LLC.
I've never heard of that.
Okay. 160, they said that he put them out of business, but it's, they're calling them a patent troll.
A lot of those are being handled out of the Eastern District of Texas because they have a rocket docket. They've specialized in patent cases. Mm.
So I wonder if that's a good thing that he did it, or.
Well, if they're a true patent troll, then.
Yeah.
I would assume so.
I guess it depends on which side of the case you're on.
Yeah, that's true. For us.
Well, I don't know. I guess it depends on who us is.
Is also true.
Nick, do you want to talk about the fact that Amazon is not going to sell Chromecast or Apple TV? Did you read about it? Talk about it?
I don't know if there's much to talk about. I mean, Amazon, it makes sense. Why would you sell your competitor's stuff if you got something that you think's better? I don't know how much there is to say. I mean,
I don't know. It seems like, I mean, Amazon is a place that sells. I mean, they are a store,
but they're more than a store. They're more than a store now. They're no longer online. They're no longer a store.
Well, but they are also a store.
They're a manufacturing store. Years ago, they were just a store that was selling third-party products. Now, I bought a mouse this week off Amazon Basic. The keyboard's Amazon Basic, but USB my HDMI cables are Amazon Basic. They're a manufacturer now. They're more than just a store, so it makes perfect sense. You got something that's beating you out on sales, beating out your product on sales. Don't offer it. Smart move maybe.
Time will tell.
What are people going to do? Stop boycotting Amazon? I mean.
They are citing compatibility issues with Prime Video. Amazon emailed marketplace sellers. They told them that they're not accepting new listings for the two media devices.
Mm-hmm.
And any existing listings will be removed at the end of October.
There you go.
The move indicates not only the importance Amazon places on its streaming Prime Video service, but also that it views Apple and Google as serious rivals.
The Google thing, Chromecast thing, I don't really understand because the Chromecast and the Fire TV really aren't the same thing, but I totally understand the Apple TV. Plus, I don't know who would buy an Apple TV.
The two companies have yet to respond to the news. But
yeah, very, very interesting.
Yeah. Yes, it is. So, yeah, Nick, I started telling you that about yesterday in the blab, and Mike went through the setting for Mix Minus and how it actually works and all that. It was a very good lesson. There were people in there that were just sitting there. There was one production manager somewhere that it was technical guy, and he was just taking it in. I mean, they liked it. And I wanted to get to a way that I can use Blab and Wirecast without the echo, and the thing that that Mike finally figured out is I had to lower my aux send for that channel, close it down, and it worked. I mean, that's the one that if I turn it down now, nobody would hear the hangout. And I know, I mean, and Mike was trying to do that remotely.
Well, that, but that's the point, Amnon. I didn't finally figure it out. I knew exactly how to do it, but without being able to look at which card is plugged into the computer or which aux end is connected to which card, it's kind of difficult to do remotely.
That's what I meant. That not being here is it takes somebody like Mike to be able to do it remotely.
Amnon, see, this is the point. Let me say this.
Yeah.
People say some very nice things to me from time to time, and I sincerely appreciate them.
That's
all I ask. And I'm not talking about you, obviously. We've been friends for years, but I'm talking about on the internet. And I help people, and they say some very nice things. And anyone who says they don't appreciate someone saying nice things about them is either sick or lying. Obviously, I do appreciate that. That's what keeps me going. That's why I do it. That's why I like to help.
Sure.
What you and I did yesterday is not in any way, shape, or form difficult. It's not.
To you, it's not.
Right.
For you,
Because I've invested the time to understand what's going where. All right. So if, for example, how hard is it, Amnon, for you to change an alternator on a car?
Not hard.
It's not, I mean, you don't, it's just something, I'm going to go change an alternator, and you know that there's a 99.9% chance that it's going to work.
Right.
Assuming the alternator is good, which you can't really rely on much anymore.
Right.
Right. I mean, it's just not a challenge. That's the way these things are to me. They're not challenging to me, not because I'm smart, but because I've invested, the time to understand how these things work. So I get that. But it's one of those things that mix minus is not difficult. It's difficult to understand the first time when you did it. It's a kick yourself in the, you know what moment, because it is so simple. I mean, how many times have you taken on a challenge in your life and that you've dreaded doing that you didn't? Well, I don't know. Wait a minute. That wasn't so bad. That's mix minus.
Those of you that saying that stream up is, I mean, I see Minor LA saying that the stream up is freezing. You can go back to ConnectCast, which is a lot faster. But I'm on stream up and it looks fine to me. Mike, you need higher speed.
Yeah, Mike.
That's the problem. Yep.
Yeah. I did run a speed. You can switch away from me while I'm eating, Amnon. I did a speed test this morning, and my download is down to 600 megabits.
Oh my God. Cancel with your cable company.
Absolutely.
The upload was still 900, so I'm okay.
Wow. Now I cannot get into ConnectCast.
It's fine. Don't worry about it. People are still watching because they're commenting, so.
There it is. Okay. Took time to get there for some reason. Okay, let's see what this. I wonder what happened to Hermine.
Well, you told her to come in anytime.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but you know when she said she's gonna be there at 9, I figured she'll be here at 10. I mean, it's 10:45. iFixit, and who hasn't used their website?
Is that a rhetorical question?
The fix-it-yourself advocate for users of Apple, Google, and other gear has had its repair manual app banned from Apple's App Store after it conducted an authorized teardowns of Apple TV and Siri remote. And go back to, there's something going on with Time Warner. Go back to stream up. It's yellow again. So they pulled out their repair manual from the Apple App Store after it conducted an authorized teardown of the Apple TV and Siri. Apparently they did not want them to do it. iFixit blogged, "We are a teardown and repair company. Teardowns are in our DNA, and nothing makes us happier than figuring out what makes these gadgets tick. We weighted the risks. Blithely tossed those risks over our shoulder. Is that the right way to say it? Blithely? And tore down the Apple TV anyway. iFixit still have Windows and Android apps and has no immediate plans to rewrite its Apple app to attempt being reinstalled. The fact that they took it off of their store, the app store, that doesn't mean that it disappears from the internet. That just means that people are not going to be able to get it from there. Besides,
but it means people on the Apple TV can't get it.
Yeah, but I mean, people that use Apples don't need to have anything.
I fix it. That's why it's big. But Amnon, the reason their content, their success is driven by viewers, and that's a huge audience that now they're losing out on.
No.
So I disagree.
I guess time will tell who's going to lose. Do people with Apples and Apple TV and stuff would need it to know how to fix it?
It's not, no. Well, yeah, but they pulled the whole app. The app does more than just the Apple TV.
You know what? Keep it going. I'm going to change something. Real.
Give me some. Keep it going with what? I don't have anything.
You don't see anything?
No. I don't have anything to keep it going.
No. I'm sorry. But did you get the video back?
On what?
I saw you saying you lost it.
Yeah, I lost it on ConnectCast. I'm on StreamUp. Don't worry about it. Just tell everybody to go there. Not the end of the world.
And it's back. I mean, it's right again.
It's been raining.
I don't know what's going on with Time Warner, but I was hoping that they are bringing back, implementing Max. But apparently not.
Rain.
I was going to do a ConnectCast from here.
Kind of late now.
Okay.
You can if you want to, but
no, I mean it's fine. It's fine. That's really weird. I mean, if at any time you see that ConnectCast or Daily Motion is down, just click on StreamUp. For those of you that don't understand why one work and another will not. The machine that I'm on, that I'm doing all the switching with, is on UVerse. And it is streaming to StreamUp. It's sending the signal also to the other machine that is on Time Warner, which is streaming to ConnectCast and Daily Motion. So that's why when Time Warner, something happens to Time Warner, StreamUp is still going. Now, yes, if UVerse will go down, then you will still be able to see just me on the other, on ConnectCast and Daily Motion, because the machine is not going to die. It's going to send the video over there, but the guys on the Hangout are not going to be able to come in. Because it's not on the internet. The machine is not on the internet. Just so if somebody is wondering why it's working that way. And I don't know. It may be that they're having problems. Is it? I can't look outside. I'm wondering if it's windy and maybe they're having problems with their Soyvis. That it looks
probably
like it's back.
Our internet, our power went off for a while this morning.
All right. Yeah, I mean, ConnectCast is back. It's fine.
And plus, Time Warner is probably working on those upgrades.
They were saying that they're going, remember, they were saying they are going to implement Max on the 3rd. Well, it didn't happen yesterday, but you wouldn't expect them to do it with all the problems that people were having. So maybe they're working on it.
It was actually the 2nd they were supposed to do it.
Oh.
And they moved it out to November 3rd. Charles is apoplectic over it.
What are you doing with the guitar?
I'm just sitting here holding it.
America, he can do whatever he wants. Don't get a copyright strike, Mike.
Minor LA needs to come up there a little bit more often. Mike is spending too much time up there, and he's beginning to hold his guitar instead.
No, I got into it. This morning I was looking up some serial numbers. Some guys in a group I'm in were talking about particular models of guitars, and I remembered I had this one. I couldn't remember what year it was. So I grabbed it to look it up. It's actually the best playing guitar I've ever had. Bought it from a guy in a white van out at Crossroads about 10 years ago. No, actually about 15 or 20 years ago, $450.
All right, so I was thinking about going to 12 because there were guys that were saying they can't come in.
Let's talk about this, yeah.
Now, I see that Brian Monroe disappeared, but Brian never had that problem.
He gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Brian Aldridge is not here, right?
He gets up at noon.
But no, he normally comes in about 15 minutes before 11. And I can't remember the other people. I mean, I always see it after the show in the chat. Oh, it's gone already.
They know what time the show is.
Yeah, but I mean, it doesn't seem like we need to do that anymore because it's not being taken advantage of. What do you, I mean, let me see if anybody in the chat wants us to go till 12 o'clock.
Yeah, just here's the thing. No, this is what you got to realize, Amnon. Don't you tell me this all the time. I don't know why you're doing the same thing. If you don't have content to fill 3 hours of a show, then you do the show till you're out of content.
Right. I agree. So, and if people are not going to get involved and call in.
If you don't have content, if you are done with content at 10:52 a.m., and if people say go until 12, well, you can't. You don't have anything to go until 12 to. You tell me that all the time. I'm surprised that you're asking it like that.
I just want to see what people would say. I mean, type in 11 or 12 in the chat. Then when do you want the show to end? And I would expect.
I want more than that. I want a reason.
There have been so many connection problems today. I'm not so sure how many people are still listening. I see Dr. John's had to log in for the 3rd time.
Now you see that shouldn't happen because the chat never went down.
Whatever.
Chat is nothing to unless his connectivity went down. Because the chat, remember, the chat is hosted on Delta Force's servers up at level 3. That has not gone down, or I would have bells going on in my office.
Well, having said all that, this would be an interesting time. If you want to go from 11 to 12, this would be an interesting time to bring in a blab.
Yeah, but we decided that we still cannot do it because of the echo. Because if I lower
that's not the reason.
Oh.
That's the effect. The reason is that you have it on the same computer.
Yeah, on the same computer. I understand. Okay.
That's a trivial fix.
Because of the setup, right now we can't do it.
Correct.
Okay. Now, I need to run this by you guys because I'm not necessarily sure I agree with this blab idea. You can't I I don't feel comfortable if you guys are just going to go into some random blab and say, hey, you guys are now on the air with this other audience on our, on the internet. I don't know if people necessarily.
No. That's not
start a new one.
That's not it.
Oh, start a new one. Okay.
No, it will be our blab.
Okay.
To allow people to come into our blab and join the show. No, it's not good. No.
I was going to say
that would be very
uncomfortable.
I misunderstood you when we were talking, I guess.
All right. Well, glad we got that out of the way.
See, AG and say he will stay until noon, but
I get that. But if you don't have content, are you just going to sit there and
if there's nothing to talk about, if there is no, I mean, we can come up with just so much stuff to talk about.
I can play guitar for you.
And then we run out. And the news and problems are less and less every week. As time goes on and these machines that we're using, computers, are getting to be tools, you don't have as many problems as when somebody's sitting in front of the machine and trying to do something just because they have a computer and they want to do something with it. Like in the early days. So we need interaction, question, somebody to call in, because that allows for a fresh discussion of something, somebody with fresh idea, new blood, so to speak, to the show. And that will take it, you know, you add 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there, 15 minutes here, and things work out. But for us, I agree with Nick 100%. We cannot be sitting here and talking, because the truth is I've got two more stories and that's it. And I'm sure that many of these stories are not interested to everybody.
There's only so much you can do.
Yeah, right. Tim is asking, what is a blab?
Yeah, well.
You can go.
Why don't you explain it? You're an expert in blab.
Well, I'm not an expert, but I know enough about it to say you go to blab.im, and it is a video sort of like meeting service where four people can get together and other people can be in chat, and they just talk amongst themselves. It is, I don't know how new it is. It's not old. And some people are beginning to try to do shows on it. You control who comes in, who doesn't come in onto video. Everybody can be in the chat. You cannot have private blabs. The main reason that I don't see it becoming a replacement for anything is because of the way that it's being run. It's also, and Mike is going to have something to say here, since I've been using wide format and now HD, that's not what it's there. You have four squares. There's a lot of things that work against it, but it's great for what it is. But really, you have to experience it yourself. And you can go and just watch people talking, and you can see the subject of what they're talking about. And in most cases, the subject is correct. It's neat. And we were talking about it, and we were discussing, you know, what's good about it. And the good thing about it is it's going to appeal to a lot of lonely people. People that sit at home all day, they have nothing to do, and they're lonely. You go there, and you can find something that interests you, and you can get into talking with other people, and it's good because it now it gives your life a purpose, so to speak. There are people there that stay, as far as I know, all day long, because I'll go and check Blab IM maybe 3-4 times a day to see if anything that I'm interested in is going on. And you see the same people. So it's kind of eerie. So that's what it is, Tim. It's a public meeting. It's sort of like you go to the bar and people are sitting at tables and you can, and they're talking and they're not going to frown upon you standing over somebody's shoulder and watching and listening. And if one of the seats, somebody gets up and say bye and they invite you, you can sit there and actually take part in the conversation. That's what it is. Mike, did you freeze?
Out of my knowledge.
Oh, you were. Gosh, maybe something here, because the minute you said not to my knowledge, you started... The picture changed. That's maybe, I don't know, it may be something here. And it's when they're talking about business, I don't know how you're going to market this to a business with the name Blab, because the word itself has kind of what am I trying to say? Negative connotation, is that the word? Yep. So, but well, I think that was for some time. But if you can go and do it for yourself and see what's happening on Blab. Connotation. You know, you go and you tell the business, yeah, you know, you can get on Blab and what? So, but what we thought and what Nick was talking about is that we were thinking that we can start a Blab and bring it in to the show as another participant, so to speak, and and allow more people to get involved, because it seems like our audience interacts with us in the chat only. And over there will be people who will be actually talking and be on video. And by the way, I mean, if there are any of you in the chat, our core audience, that want to come in and be on video to ask, it can be arranged.
I don't think people are interested in that.
I don't think so either.
People don't even want to call in.
Yeah, right. Idle chatter. Well, it's true, Dr. John. That's what it stands for. But there are some interesting discussions going on there. Yesterday, somebody started a Blab about the shooting in Oregon and gun control, and what do people think? And it was very interesting. And I had a customer over here who has something to do with the legislator. And no, that was Friday. And we were sitting watching, because remember now, these are people from all over the world, and people from Europe are chiming in, and people from Canada are chiming in. It was a very interesting conversation. And you learn from other people about what's happening in their countries. So, yeah, oh, I see what you mean. Yeah. It's the name to go and tell somebody a blab. You know, what is it? But the truth is there are some good, there are some, most of the things that are going on in there these days are marketing, coaching, people trying to drum up business, how to make a fast buck, how to do this. And I'm sure that the blab people, because it's still in beta, will let anything go in, and they're glad for anything because it helps them clean up the service, the software itself. So it's I don't see it going away anytime soon with the blabs, all the those pyramid schemes and marketing and all that. But the thing that will take it down is every now and then, and this is nice, don't let your kids be on it on their own. Because every now and then, there'll be somebody who went in, who would go in there and expose themselves. It seems like people like that are all over the place for some reason.
See, now you're going to get their server slammed.
The what?
The what?
What did you say? I didn't.
Now you're going to get their server slammed. Everybody's going to be running over there trying to find somebody, catch somebody exposing themselves.
If people are after that, I'm sure there are other places they can go to.
That's true. Nobody would ever watch porn on the internet.
But that's what Blab, and we thought that maybe we can bring people who are interested in technology over here to see. And we'll work on it. That may be a simple solution. Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, I'm gonna start having a podcasting course.
Yeah.
I've been working on the name for it. I need to know what you guys think about this.
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
The podcast answer coach, passive on fire mastermind entrepreneur, shiny new object podcasting, 5-hour work course.
I couldn't set it better myself.
What do you think?
Give me your PayPal and just send you some money.
Did I miss anything?
No, I think you got. Do you have snake oil in there?
Yeah, I say on fire.
And then you're good.
Podcast answer, that's snake oil.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. John wants to sign up.
Cool. Just send money. It'll set you free. Blessings will fall from heaven.
This just doesn't fit or mean to be.
Am I an expert? Well, it depends. What's an expert? Does that mean I know more than you do? I guess it depends on the topic.
Yeah.
Imagine if that's a real PhD, I'm sure you know a whole lot more about a whole lot more things than I do.
So I guess it is
time to put a cork in it.
Yep. That's a good way to put it.
Dr. John, I'm getting older, and sometimes things don't stick with me like they used to. We may have, I don't recall.
I'm not going there.
I saw Dr. John, the performer.
The what?
The what?
What did you say? You saw Dr. John what?
I got a doctorate in BS, don't we all?
See, right now you're real low.
Did it change, Nick?
You're not talking as loud, but I wouldn't say you're real low.
Yeah, because I mean I'm hitting 4 bars in the hangout.
All right. Well.
So I suspect something fishy is going on in the hangout. We'll test it later today, see if it does the same thing then.
I can't smell
it. But let's just wrap it up now.
Okay. Well, it was fun. It was fun.
Yep.
Thanks, everybody. Oh, you know, I didn't even... I can't believe that. What happened to Steve?
He was busy this week.
I hope.
Yeah, well, you are. Yeah. I would assume he's just Nick, busy.
You're real low.
What?
Nothing.
Yeah, just he's probably busy. People have lives.
All right, well. So, good morning, Kathy, Hannah, Nabil, Mac, Norm, Katie, and Donna. Thank you, everybody, for tuning to Computers 2K Now. We hope you enjoyed and maybe learned something from our time together. Remember to practice safe computing, back up your hard drive, and update your virus scanner. We'll be back here next Sunday at 9, but you can always reach us at computers2know.com. While you're at it, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Tonight at 8, it's a rerun of Tanya's show. See you, everybody.
Tune to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now with Amnon Nissan, Health In with Debbie Brooke, Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Lessons of Vietnam with NCVVI members, The Tanya Love Show, Your Healthy Pet with Gisela DiCarlo, and if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it at www.nissancommunications.com. Sponsored by Atomos.com, makers of quality video recorders and converters for professionals. CarolinaApparel.com and DeltaForce.net.